in my hometown, Clifton Forge, Virginia, one of the major activities of young men, both black and white, in the late 30s and during World War II, was to go to the Saturday matinee to see cowboy movies. They would start, you know, around 12 o'clock and have two showing. The black kids, we sat in segregated seats, of course. The cowboys were always white. They represented the good guys. And of course, the soldiers were always white. The settlers were always white. And then you had these bad guys, the Indians. And then you had bad guys, the outlaws. And it was the same scenario each Saturday, you know, some outlaw trying to take a farm or a ranch away, or some settlers moving across the frontier, and they were just trying to get to a new home, and these vicious Indians would attack. And always the Indians would always be about to win when the cavalry would come and whatnot. And we never saw, you know, any blacks playing any of these roles. And I recall, was yesterday, they showed the preview for the next Saturday show. And we saw a black man in cowboy dress. He was driving a wagon. We didn't observe that it was really a mule. He was pulling the wagon, And we were shocked, a black cowboy. Well, somehow it went through our mind that this black cowboy would do what the other cowboys did, to be brief. Well, we looked forward to the next Saturday. And on that particular day, an hour before the show, the streets were lined with young, black males. The theater owner and the police didn't know what to make of all of it. I remember one friend of mine was shoved by a local policeman with the statement, "You picking ninnies, stop blocking the street." And they couldn't imagine why, what was about this show that made us want to get there. And so when the movie started, sure enough, this black guy shows up and they inform him that the wagon train's about to move out. He was part of a wagon train, and that would be Indians, out there. And he made some comical statement, which began to wonder, because we had been accustomed to only seeing black clowns, but not a black clown who was a cowboy. And so he made some statements. He hoped he doesn't see any Indians and this, that, and the other. And so, sure enough, as they got out a day or so, I suppose, someone came riding back that the engines are coming. And there was great excitement, and the wagons were drawn into a circle. And so they told this. Now, his name bothered us also, because when we first saw him, someone said Fat Meat. And we couldn't believe that was his name. We found out later that was indeed his name, Fat Meat. So we'll call him Fat Meat now. Now, when the Indians attacked, they proceeded to circle the wagons and just run around the wagon, and the settlers shot them off the horses. Now, that wasn't quite the way the Indians fought, but that's the way they show it. And so they tried to get Fat Meat to take a gun. And Fat Meat was trembling, and he was afraid. And so they insisted that you take a gun. And so they actually forced the gun into Fat Meat's hand, a rifle. And he was so afraid of it that he dropped it. Then he pulled out reached in his pocket, trembling, and pulled out a barber's razor. And he was trembling and dropped that. And he got down on his knees to try to pick it up with his teeth. And about that time, an arrow went over his head. And if he had been standing up, it would hit him, dead center. And so he saw the arrow and was so terrified that they used that way they speed up a camera or slow it down. I think it slowed it down to make it look as the person has superhuman speed. And he took off, you know, you could hardly see him running. And he jumped in the wagon with the children. And he was so terrified. And a young little white girl, looked like she may have been 6, 7 years old, tried to comfort him. And she told him that her daddy wasn't going to let the mean old Indians harm him. And there the children were trying to comfort our black hero, you see. And we were totally, you know, couldn't believe what we were seeing. And then after the raid, now what happened, it was announced that ammunition was out, was about to go, and the Indians would surely come and annihilate everybody. And they prepared for it. And just at the proper moment, a bugle sound across the way, and it was the United States Cavalry. And of course, at the moment the bugle sounded, the Indians took off, which wasn't always the case. And so the wagon train was saved. And so they brought Fat Meat out. They had to hold him up. He was still shaking. And he saw a dead Indian, and he fainted. Now, I got back to school. I was in the fifth grade. My teacher was George Linton Davis. He's now Dr. George Linton Davis. But anyway, I asked him about this. And he told me that it was, this is the what movies were doing, telling you, you know, trying to pass these stereotypes on to you. But he told me something that shocked me, and maybe he got me interested in black history. He told me that a third of the cowboys were black, and they were not like Fat Meat. And he also told me that about half the soldiers that fought the Indians were black. And this is what introduced me to the black buffalo soldiers. I had never heard that term before. We had seen nothing but clowns. So it was just something more of the same. And we probably felt that, you know, how stupid we were to have thought otherwise, to have seen Fat Meat, you know, shoot some Indians or beat up some cowboys and ride off into the sunset. You know, we were fairly naive to even thought that after we had seen the film. And it was, I never will forget that. over 50 years ago, I guess it happened.